Introduction?
Yes, yes, it's looking good.
Okay, good. Okay, then I start again here. So you can see this kind of structures in the H-alpha line. And because of this round structures here, they are called bow shocks in the astronomy. But a bow shock is, or a shock is usually an infinitesimal structure. You don't see really the bow shock, which is the outer boundary of this structure, but you see the material behind the bow shock. And there are also other observations which doesn't really look like a bow shock, but this is also an astrosphere where you have here in this core, you have the bow shock, and then you have here a long extended tail because of the turbulence in the interstellar medium. You have this kind of structures, or you can see here this very nice type of bow shock, which is a kind also of a Mach cone, which you can see here. And then you have the other structures here, with this elongated tails or things like that. So what is an astrosphere is we have, for instance, sitting here in the middle, the star, which is this yellow dot. And from this star, we have a so-called stellar wind emanating. That is, the atmosphere of the star is expanding. And we have the number density of the particles, which are mainly protons, which have a velocity, which is usually supersonic or better super fast magnetosonic. Then we have the pressure or the temperature, which you usually cannot observe in the stellar environment. And we have the magnetic field, which you also cannot really observe in the stellar wind, but we can observe the temperature or pressure at the star surface. And the other thing is when we have a supersonic or super fast magnetosonic wind, this pressure is not really important, but the ramp pressure is important. That is a product of the density and the square of the velocity. And the magnetic field is a problem. You can get an idea what the field in the wind is when you know the field of the surface of the star and then extrapolate it to the wind. Usually these features here extend, depending on what kind of stars you are looking. We have, the astronomers say it's parsec scale. That means one parsec is 10 to the 18.5 centimeters or 10 to the 13.5 kilometers. So it's quite large. And then what you have, this kind of super fast flow enters, hits the interstellar medium, which is coming from top. And you can see that we have here also the density, the velocity of the interstellar medium, pressure and temperature and the magnetic field. And these parameters are usually known to some extent. It depends where you are in the galaxy. Sometimes it's not really known. The interstellar magnetic field is always a problem because you do not know it locally. You know it on a much larger scale than you need to model the astrosphere. So you have to also to assume some make some assumptions to determine the magnetic field. Okay, now if the velocity of the interstellar medium is zero, that means that the star is not moving with respect to the interstellar medium. We have here this red line, a termination shock, where the stellar wind undergoes a transition to a subsonic wind. And then we have, it is here called the astropause, or in the for the sun, it's called the heliopause. This structure here, which is tangential discontinuity, which separates the interstellar medium from the stellar wind medium. And if the stellar wind, or if the wind is coming here and is also supersonic, you have also this bow shock structure. Also, if you have no velocity, this bow shock is traveling into the interstellar medium, and you have this nice bubble-like structure if you are thinking in three dimensions. Now, if you have a wind velocity, then this figure becomes extended, and you have here the wind velocity, the shocked wind velocity is turning around into what we call the tail in this direction, and also the interstellar flow is flowing around the astropores in this kind of manner. Usually we have here a region which is subsonic, and here we have also a region which is subsonic, but this is a kind of quite complicated structure which I will explain in a moment. Then, depending on how strong the stellar wind magnetic field is, you may get some kind of this structure, which is extended jet-like structures, but that was not observed until now. It's a possibility, but seems not to be realized. And what we have, the problem with the magnetic field, the interstellar magnetic field, if that is not aligned to the inflow, this is indicated here by this magenta field lines and the blue inflow lines, then you get an asymmetric shape of the astrosphere, because the Boshock is becoming asymmetric, and also the astropores is becoming asymmetric, while the termination shock here, this red line, almost remains the same. It's not really round. I will come to that in a moment. Now, we know, for instance, if you have a hydrodynamic shock structure, this kind of complicated feature, which I will explain you in a moment, this works only if you have no magnetic field involved. You have, from the left, the interstellar medium with some velocity, supersonic velocity streaming into the system. And you have here in the middle the star, and then you have the solar wind, which is supersonic, which is indicated here with the index one. So they have here a solar wind, a supersonic solar wind, which undergoes then a transition to a subsonic stellar wind, indicated always with an index two. And that we have also here with the ism, we call it one and two. One is always the shock, the supersonic region, and two is always the subsonic region. And also because the wind is coming from that side, we call this the side where the wind comes from, upwind, and the side where the wind goes down is called downwind side. And then we have also, that is a little bit confusing, downstream and upstream. Upstream is always in the direction seen from the shock surface, in the direction where you have the supersonic flow coming, and downstream is then from the termination, from the shock surface, where the subsonic flow escapes. And that, therefore, the upstream and downstream region is at the shock different than in the termination shock. Because then you have an inflow, you have this elongated structure of the termination shock, and then you have here kind of triple point where the shock transition is not any longer allowed by entropy conditions, and what is called here Mach disk. This kind of structure was detected by Planck in 1890s or so. And then you have a tangential discontinuity, which emerges from this triple point, and you get some reflected shocks here. These shocks are reflected at the tangential discontinuity, which is this blue line here, passing into the tail. And at the tail, you have also then some Mach disk or shock transition, where you have to go from the subsonic region again into a supersonic region, because you have to adapt to the interstellar medium. We have then here the bow shock, and then this region between bow shock and astropores is called outer astrosheath, and the region between the astropores and the termination shock is called the inner astrosheath. I know that's very complicated, but it starts to become more complicated, because we have here the Mach number, which is larger than one. Then you go over the pass over the shock, you get the Mach number, which is smaller than one. But that is only the case if you have in a region close around the inflow line, which is called the nose direction. When you go further away, you get something which is called a sonic line, where you have a transition from a subsonic to a supersonic flow. The reason is that if you take the flow normal to the surface, then only the normal velocity is shocked and the tangential velocity is not shocked. And you can see here that here the tangential velocity passes over the shock without being changed. And if that tangential velocity is larger than the speed of sound, then you get here this Mach number larger than one fluid. The same happens in the astrosheaths. This dashed line here is called stagnation line because at the astropores you have a point where there is no velocity. The shocked wind passes from the termination shock to the astropores and from the stagnation line to the astropores, and that is a streamline, and that means that the sum of the thermal pressure and the square of the velocity is more or less conserved, and that means at that point here you have to have a region where you have no flow speed actually. That is the complicated structure for an HD flow. The problem with an HD flow is that the tangential discontinuity here, this astropores, is notoriously unstable, so you get a lot of turbulences floating around here. But if you go to the MHD structure, that becomes much more complicated. Because when you have an HD structure, you have the propagation speed, which is only the sound speed. When you have an MHD structure, that is much more complicated because you get the Alfvén speeds, the fast and the slow magnetosonic speeds, which are also propagation speeds. And you have to take these three waves into account when you want to discuss or model this structure. I plotted that. Yeah, now here I have written down the set of equations which we have to solve. It's a kind of matrix writing. We have here the time derivative, partial time derivative of the density, the momentum flow, the energy flow, and the magnetic field flow. And here we have then the divergence of the flux, where this product Vj means that we have here the matrix. J is the index of the fluid which you have in mind. You can have a couple of fluids. For instance, you can have protons or helium ions, or you can have also neutrals included here in this kind of equations. And you have to solve a separate set of these equations. It's more complicated. You have here the thermal pressure. E is the unit tensor and or 3x3 matrix. Then you have a dyadic product with the magnetic field here subtracted in the momentum equation. The momentum equation is also sometimes called the equation of motion. Then you have a more similar part by the energy equation, and that is the induction equation written in a little bit more complicated way. The reason why we do that is if you look into that part, when you have a stationary part, it means this part vanishes and the right hand side vanishes. This part here, the divergence is conserved. So this is also called the conservative MHD equations. Then we have on the right hand side a couple of things which we can add. What we have to do in modeling for the astrospheres is to add a cooling and a heating function, because what can happen is if you have some reconnection or so have then some neutrals in your material, then you may have some photons which escape the system, and then you lose some energy which is given here by this lambda term. And if you have some photons hitting the neutrals or so, and or the protons, then you can get some heating function here too. And on the and then if you have a coupled system of equations, which is usually the case for cool stars like the heliosphere, then you have to add here a neutral fluid, and you have here the charge exchange terms. That means an electron or changes from one from a proton or from a hydrogen atom to a proton, and you have some photoionization effects or so on. I will come to that later. And here in this gray shaded area, you can have some other terms like stress tensor, viscosity, and so on, or external forces which we usually don't take into account in the astrospheres. Now, to clear what is meant with sound speed and shock waves, we have the characteristics for in a 1D Riemann problem. I only talk for the 1D Riemann problem. You can do that also in a 3D, which is more complicated, but not really gives you something new. We have three characteristics. We have the sound speed, and we have the bulk speed of the fluid, and then you have a shock wave when you have the flout, the sound, the fluid speed plus minus the sound speed, which can go to the left if it's minus and to the right if it's it goes to the right, and we have the tangential discontinuity which is escaping here along the time with the sound speed usually. And so, then you have these three types of waves which can escape. And what you then do is you look to get a physical solution, what it, does the entropy do, and is the entropy conserved in one of the three cases? It's only conserved in one of these cases. You use that as a physical solution. If you now go to MHD model, you have 11 characteristics, as I told you. We have the fast shock or ramification fan. We have the alphen or rotational discontinuity, and we have a slow shock and the tangential discontinuity. This is somehow color-coded here. We have the fast wave propagating to the right or to the left. Then we have the rotation discontinuity. I come to that in a moment. We have the slow wave moving into this direction. We have a tangential discontinuity moving in this direction. And here is the time, and you can see this figure is no longer symmetric around the time axis, so it's also in that sense more complicated. And now you also calculate the entropy for all these seven cases to get the conservation of the entropy to get the physical solution. And this is done by a code called Kronos, which was developed by Ralf Gissmann and colleagues in 2018. And here is the scheme, how it is calculated for 1D Riemann solver with different schemes, Hartree, Lee, and Lux. And I don't know what that deans means. Forgetting that, but you can easily find that in that reference here, and you can see it's a quite complicated part. My part, or the part for the user of this code, is to write the initial conditions and the parameters at the time when you want to start, and then you go through this scheme and calculate here, for instance, the characteristic velocities, the numerical fluxes, and the computational changes, and then you go through that until you have get some final resolution and you store the data here. And you can imagine that in 3D it's much more complicated. And the problem are the characteristic velocities. And the characteristic velocities are also needed to determine the so-called CF conditions, the current free trace conditions. That means the time step which you have to use. It is determined how fast or by the length of the cell which you have divided by the characteristic velocity which you have in mind. And that gives you the time times a small factor which you have to integrate. And you can imagine the smaller the cells become, the longer you have to run, because then the time step here becomes quite small. And that means if you have, for instance, spherical flow, it does not matter so much what is your radial component doing, but if you increase the resolution of the angle, the angular code, and no, codes, then you get much shorter times which you have here to use, and then the code runs much longer. It's because you have phi and theta and the time step, so you get almost a factor 8 when you double the cell sizes in theta and phi. That makes a problem. Okay, now the MHD shock types and discontinuous I will shortly discuss. And you see we have here a variety of shocks which we can have in the system. They are not all observed in the astrospheres, but in the heliospheres we can observe the right-hand shocks in the interplanetary medium. What we have is we have a switch-off and switch-on shock. That means we have here a shock. As the medium is coming from the left, is shocked, and then you have on the right-hand side, you have a tangential magnetic field. Or if you have a switch-off shock, the tangential magnetic field on the shock side is switched off on the subsonic side. Then you have a fast shock where the magnetic field is amplified. It is only here for the tangential magnetic field component, and for the if you have a slow shock, the tangential magnetic field component is decreased. And then we have the intermediate shock where you decrease the magnetic field and also change the direction. The fast and slow shocks are observed, and the switch on, off and on shocks, as well as the intermediate shocks, are called non-evolutionary. That means that the small perturbation either brings it on the slow shock or a fast shock. So they are not really observed, but the fast and slow shock are observed. I will show you. And then we have discontinuities. We have a tangential discontinuity, which is also given in hydrodynamics. It's also the same stuff, except that we have no magnetic fields. That means the tangential component is zero. And then we have the normal component is not passing through the tangential discontinuity. We don't have any flux through this tangential discontinuity. The density on both sides can jump because it can be different fluids, as well as the tangential velocity and the tangential magnetic field. The only thing which has to be balanced is the pressure and the magnetic field, tangential magnetic field pressure. If you have a contact discontinuity, you have a magnetic field flux on both sides, and then the only thing which can, or all the state which can jump, is the density, and that means that on both sides you may have this, different densities, but the same tangential velocities, tangential fields, and the same pressure. This kind of stuff is used in or was used in tokamaks to keep the hot material away from the walls, otherwise they would melt. And then we have an additional discontinuity where we have also the normal component of the flux is not zero, but here it happens only that the magnetic field is rotating. And that means also the density is the same on both sides. The tangential velocity jumps, the tangential velocity magnetic field jumps, but as you can see, the tangential magnetic field pressure or the magnetic field pressure is the same, and also the pressure is the same. Unfortunately, in literature, the tangential discontinuity and the contact discontinuity are usually mixed. The contact discontinuity is not really applicable to astrospheres, but a lot of authors use contact discontinuity instead of tangential discontinuity. It's always a tangential discontinuity, just to make things short. Now we have a model which we called, we have a star, Lambda Cephei, which has a mass loss rate of 1.5 times 10 to the minus 6 solar masses per year. To remind you, the Sun has a mass loss rate of 10 to the minus 14 solar masses per year. The terminal velocity is 2,500 kilometers per second. That means the stellar wind speed is like that. And the solar wind speed is something between 400 and in fast speeds we have 800 kilometers per second. So this is quite a bit larger. That is a spectral type for the specialist. And the distance of that star is 650 parsecs. It's quite far away. And then we have a radial velocity of 80 kilometers. This radial velocity is always debate between astronomers and modelers, because we take this radial velocity as the velocity at which the interstellar medium is flowing towards the star. But the astronomers usually make a difference between if the medium moving to the star, is the star moving into the medium, or are both moving in the same direction. From modeling points, that is not a problem, because we always sit at the star and look what happens in front of the star in the upwind direction, and that is the speed which we then take. The interstellar magnetic field, we have some density, which is given here at the boundary for that star, which is 2 particles per cubic centimeter. The interstellar medium has 11 particles per cubic centimeter. Velocity is, as I said, 2,580. Temperature is assumed to be 450 Kelvin at 0.3 parsec in the boundary, and at 9,000 Kelvin at the interstellar medium. And the magnetic field at the surface is given with 10 to the 7 nanotesla, 4 times 10 to the 7 nanotesla, and 1 nanotesla in the ISM. And the nice thing is, this is the magnetic field at the surface, the 10 to the 7 nanotesla, which has then transported towards the 0.03 parsec boundary. And because we have a large Skripkin sphere, which is about 50 parsecs, we have no neutrals. The Skripkin sphere is defined by the distance at which the ionization rate from the star, from the photons of the star, is equal to the recombination rate, and this is far away. And as you can we'll see in a moment, the structure here is around 1 to 10 parsecs at least. So we have not to take into account neutrals. And here you can see then some model which we made at CHPC. You can see here this gray shaded area is the astropause, and then you can see the magnetic field here in the inside. It's quite a bit chaotic, and you can see this reddish area is the interstellar magnetic field. And then we have turned that around, and you can see here this orange straight lines are the undisturbed magnetic field in the interstellar medium, and this red and greenish lines are then the disturbed magnetic field lines, which wrap around the astropause in this case. Here we have cut through the XY plane, and we have plotted here different Mach numbers. We have, for instance, here the sound Mach number. You can see we have here quite complicated structure. If you look only on the sound Mach number, we have this corns or whatever it is. And you can also see we have here this sonic line passing from subsonic to supersonic again, which goes back into the tail. Somewhere here is the astropause, which this is this line here, and this is then the tangential discontinuity emerging from the triple point, which you can see here, and you can see that thing here has not really fully developed. We could have had let it longer run, but this is a run for real time of 1 million years, and the lifetime of the stars, of these old stars, is something between 1 million to 10 million years. So this structure is almost at the end of the lifetime of the star. On the right-hand side, you see the fast magnetosonic Mach number, and you can see here that we have in the transition from the high speed in this white area to a subsonic region, which is this gray area, and this white area is again the supersonic, as a super fast magnetosonic stellar wind. And you can see here we have not very much structure. There is some structure in the when you go into the flanks in the fast magnetosonic Mach number, and you can see here also the triple points, but there is no much structure from the interstellar wind side. Then we have here on that left lower plot, we have plotted the Alfheim Mach number, which you can see have here also some nice structures. This is maybe interesting for particle accelerations, and especially this feature here, which is the Mach number for the slow magnetosonic wave. And you can see we have also here some nice structures, and some people or scientists who do acceleration of cosmic rays claim that these slow shocks are also some nice accelerator sizes, but that we haven't checked yet. Now, when we want to compare our model with some observations which I have shown at the beginning, we have, for instance, three axes shown here in 3D around which we can rotate the model. And then we can shift that model to some distance in the sky, where the star is located. And then we have to project that onto the sky, so to get a 2D sky map. And we have to integrate then along the line of sight, which is shown here in this area. If you have a line of sight, we have this area which we have to cover, and then we get some signals here. We have go with this line of sight through that bubble and add all the contributions from the cells. The problem is that this is not so easy. If you have only a line of sight, you can do some different weightings, linear weighting or volumetric weighting, and you can see that that there are some differences, but for the radiation processes, we use usually the volumetric weighting. When we do that, we get something like these features. We have in these three plots coded the upper row is the H-alpha observations, the middle row is the cyclotron flux, and the Bremsstrahlung, sorry, and the lower row is the cyclotron flux. And then from the columns go from 0 degree, 22 degree, 45 degree, 68 and 90 degree, and you can see here this kind of structures which are developing and which are looking a little bit different. Here you have, for instance, kind of double structure, and here you have these two spots. And then you can see, for instance, in the cyclotron flux, you may have here or here a very nice Boshoff structure with some spot here, but that is smeared out here, and here on the almost right panel, you may have no really nice Boshoff structure. There is no bow actually. We have only to rotate that into these two directions because lambda Cephei is almost symmetric around one axis. For if you have more asymmetric models, we have to rotate them around all three axes. And so you can see we have one model, and with that one model we can explain a couple of structures which I have shown you at the beginning by simply rotating and projecting them to the sky. Okay, now what is most interesting nowadays is if you look at two sun-like stars like M-dwarfs, FG or K stars, because they may have planets, and these planets may host life. And because one wants to know if one can get some observations from so-called biosignatures, which is ozone or methane or something like that. How is it produced? Do we have some influences from the galactic cosmic rays or from the interstellar medium, from atomic hydrogen? I will come to that in more detail now. Now we have done some simulations of the cool star that is taken from a viewcraft from Konstantin Herbst. Most interesting is the colorful middle panel and the right hand panel, and you can see here on the left hand side we have Alpha Proxima Centauri, which is the nearest known exoplanet, or the nearest star with an exoplanet, Proxima Centauri b. And you can see here we have also again the heliopause, we have here the termination shock, but we don't have a bow shock because the inflow of the interstellar medium is super fast magnetosonic, so we don't have a bow shock. And then we have done the same parameter study for the three different cases. We have here the heliosphere in the upper part, then the lower part is Proxima Centauri, and this small inlet here is a star which is called LHS 1140, and you can see that it has a very small astrosphere. And then we can calculate the cosmic ray flux, which is shown here, and you can see we have here the Earth, and we have here the interstellar medium, and here is this blue dashed area is a cosmic ray flux of at LHS 1140, and that is much higher, about a factor, you may hardly see it, 10 or 100 higher than that of the Earth. The problem is that we did that only in a 1D approximation. So we did a cut through the model in the along the x-axis and calculated then the SDE transport equation type from here, which is better than when you use the so-called force-free application. To that you get results which are not really applicable. That was done recently by some other authors, but that is not a nice idea. What one has to do is to do that in 3D, because you can imagine that if you have a 3D astrosphere, the magnetic field over the poles is in the astrosphere is different than the magnetic field into the ecliptic. And so you have different transport properties from the poles towards the star and from the ecliptic or in the ecliptic to the star. So that is what we want to do in future. People in Potsdam are working on the 3D GCR transport problem. That is mainly Eugene Engelbrecht and Stefan Ferreira. And you see again, we have this quite complicated equation for the transport of particles, where there's a flow speed, a drift speed from the particles. Then we have a diffusion tensor in 3D, and then we have here the divergence of the velocity, and then this derivation, and maybe some sources. And here is some 1D modulation code which Eugene developed and applied to some observations by Pamela. You can see that observations are this dots, black dots with error bars, and you can see that is not fitting very nice. So it's fit, not too bad, but it's really not a good fit. So the idea is with a 3D fit, it becomes much better, because then we have also taken into account the cosmic rays from the poles. Okay, so in Bochum we are developing now it's almost done, a 3D multifluid model. That is what you use when you model the heliosphere. You have the inflow of the interstellar medium, also with not only protons, but also with hydrogens. And then you get collisions between a hydrogen, a neutral hydrogen atom, and a proton, and you exchange the electron, and you get a proton and a hydrogen again. And because the protons are decelerated in the north direction, you get something like a hydrogen wall here, which is observed, also observed by other nearby stars. And if you have this neutrals passing into after the astropores, you get so-called pick-up ions. That is when you have a fast proton starting coming from the solar wind, hitting or exchanging with the hydrogen atom from the interstellar medium, which has much lower velocities. So in the solar wind, we have here the hydrogen velocity is 25 kilometers and the proton speed is 400 kilometers per second. And then you exchange the electrons and you get a neutral, which is called HENA, hydrogen energetic neutral atom, is the shorthand notation, which has now 400 kilometers per second escaping in some arbitrary direction. And then you get a proton here, indicated by this small arrow, which has at that moment a small velocity, this is the velocity of or speed of the incoming hydrogen atom, and this is then picked up by the magnetic field and accelerated more or less to the solar wind speed. When that comes to the termination shock, it's accelerated at the termination shock by a Fermi 1 process, and you get the so-called anomalous cosmic ray. The problem is not only that you get here an additional source of cosmic rays in the range of MeV to GeV energies, but also that you have some hydrogen flow to the planet. And the strength of this hydrogen flow to the planet depends on how large your astrosphere is. So that is what we are planning to do in Bochum. And then we have this atmospheric transport, which I just told you that is this quite complicated structure, which is done by the Kiel group together with some groups in Berlin and Karlsruhe. We have here what we are doing, calculating the spectra. So we have calculated the astrospheres, and Bodgestrom is calculating the GCR flux. And then Konstantin Herbst from Kiel is taking that into the magnetospheric model and then into the atmospheric model. And this atmospheric part is then done by some others, which is quite complicated. And what we get out as a spectra, the chemical analyzers, and also the dose rates, which are important for life. If the dose rates are too high, then no life can exist, at least not as we know it. And we get also the biosignatures out of this model, that is this part here. And you can see, depending on the spectrum, we may get different biosignatures. Yeah, okay, so that's what I want to tell you. And the MHD modeling we are doing at CPHC and also in Kiel, computer in Kiel. The modeling takes about for Lambda Cephei and also for the small astrospheres in the resolution which I'm using, takes about 2 weeks runtime on 512 cores, or almost the same time. If I take more cores, I haven't understood yet what this is the reason, so I'm still looking for that. The synthetic observations, which was done by Leonard Bahlmann, that can be done on a PC or a workstation. It takes a day or so to run it. And the biosignatures, as I told you, has to go to some other groups which can do the atmospheric modeling, which is far out of the possibilities or abilities which we have. Okay, so that's all what I want to say. Some questions? Okay, I'm finished.
Okay, thanks, Klaus. So again, I give you guys opportunity for questions. Can you just pose your question directly?
Daniel, I'm not seeing any questions at the moment, so I'm going to take the opportunity, Klaus, just to ask a question or two from my side, if okay with you.
Yes, no problem.
Thanks for the presentation. Now, I cannot claim to fully understand all the technical aspects that you have presented. I mean, this is a completely new field to me, but it certainly is very interesting. I can appreciate that it is quite complex modeling to try and get all the aspects and description of this astrospheres done accurately. But maybe an ignorant question or two from my side. It is clear that there's a solar wind driving from the star in a particular direction, and it interacts, say, with interstellar medium that is also moving in a particular direction. So there's very much directional effects compared to where the sun is. So you will find these astropauses, say, in a very specific direction at a specific distance from the sun or from a star. Is that correct? I mean, and it will remain more or less, actually, in any case, in our kind of time frames, a constant, seeing that the sun and the interstellar medium is relatively constant over short periods of time. Is that correct?
Yeah, for the sun, it's correct. The time scales for the sun are now also coming into where you can take turbulences of the interstellar medium into account. The sun or the stellar wind is always assumed to be radial expansion. So there is no really a direction. It's expanding in the sphere, and so that's not a problem. The problem is then the interstellar medium, which is moving towards the star, or the star is moving into the interstellar medium. It doesn't matter which direction you are looking. And for the hydrodynamic code, it doesn't matter because you have then only one direction, and that is axisymmetric, and you have only to calculate one half plane. If you have a magnetic field, then you have the problem that the magnetic field is not usually not aligned to the inflow vector, and that gives you then a really three-dimensional problem. Also, if you have a magnetic field in the stellar wind, we have the so-called Parker field or Parker spiral field. And the Parker spiral field decays in the ecliptic like 1 over r and over the post like 1 over r square. That means that you have different structures in a 3D case over the poles towards the ecliptic. And then there are some complications which I haven't discussed yet. Is that the star or the sun, they have the cycles. The solar cycle is very well known, and other stars have the same thing. And during the solar cycle, the wind speed changes. So we have slow speeds for 400 kilometers in the ecliptic region. And then above 35 degrees below the ecliptic, you get some high-speed streams, about 800 kilometers. This also influences the details of the astropores. The Americans take that into account in their model, and also the Russians. They have quite well-developed models for the heliosphere, also taking into account the neutrals and so on. For the astrospheres, when I started, I was only looking into this hot stars, which are very high wind speeds and also high surface temperatures. So they have this large Strömken spheres where every particles are ionized, and I have only to take into account protons. That is much easier. And as I showed you, when you take into account neutral hydrogen for the cool stars, you have to be very careful what you are doing. And there is another problem which I also didn't touch. We have also in the interstellar medium 10% or so helium particles. So 10% of the interstellar medium material is helium. The 90% is more or less protons. But helium is strange because if you have neutral helium, you can do a charge exchange to helium plus or helium double plus, and you have two new channels, which you then have to to look at, and you have to look at the cross sections and all this kind of business, which makes it even more complicated.
Yeah, I can hear that this is much more complicated, much more variable than I may have assumed in my first take on this. So I mean, that adds to the complexity of describing this, I suppose, accurately. But yeah. Maybe just one quick follow-up question. I assume that when we talk about these almost these boundary areas where the astropauses and so on are modeled, that these are at much larger distances away from the sun compared to, say, the orbital planets around a star. Is it correct to say that it is the nature of these astrospheres at larger distances than the planets where it then modulates the cosmic rays that is really influencing the properties of those planets in terms of, I mean, because you made a very interesting comment about detecting possible signs of life and so on, or I'm misunderstanding something.
No, you can see here on the rest of the right panel, colorful panel, we have the heliosphere, which is that of the sun. Then we have Proxima Centauri, which is in the lower plane, and that small inlet. Then here is LHS 40, 1140. And in the past, I did some simulations in 2D, only without magnetic field. And what I did is I changed the interstellar neutral density. And I forgot the number. I think when I go to 50 particles per cubic centimeter in neutral number density, the helium pores is at the orbit of Saturn. So it's close into the solar system. Okay. That depends on the interstellar medium and the speed of the solar wind. So actually, what you need to compare are the ram pressures of the interstellar medium and the interstellar the solar wind. But if you take neutrals into account, you cannot really compare that, because you have additional protons which then flow into the system and do strange things.
Thanks, Klaus. It's certainly very interesting. I can see these are complicated models to work with. But thank you very much. Very interesting.
Thank you.
Okay. Since there's no questions, I would like to thank our speaker, Prof. Klaus Esquera, for a very interesting talk. So without wasting your time, I think it's exactly 1 o'clock now, so I adjourn this webinar.
Okay.
Thanks.
Okay, goodbye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Welcome.